don't know, we are doing a book study called Fresh Expressions. The women's group is doing it, and we're going to be talking about it over the next few months, actually. So I'll explain it when we get to the to that part of the sermon. But the scripture I wanted to share with you today is from Luke, and that's Luke 14. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus. Turning to them, he said, "Whoever comes to me and doesn't hate father and mother, spouse and children, and brothers and sisters, yes, even one's life, cannot be my disciple. Whoever doesn't carry their own cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. If one of you wanted to build a tower, wouldn't you first sit down and calculate the cost to determine whether you have enough money to complete it? Otherwise, when you have laid the foundation but couldn't finish the tower, all who see it will begin to belittle you. They will say, 'Here's the person who began construction and couldn't complete it.' Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down to consider whatever his 10,000 soldiers could go up against the 20,000 coming against him? And if he didn't think he could win, he would have sent a representative to discuss the term of peace, while his enemy was still a long way off. In the same way, none of you who are willing to give up all your possessions can be my disciple." Now, the reason I wanted to share that scripture with you is because it talks about planning. It talks about being smart about the future. And it talks about us thinking about what's happening down the road. So I wanted us to hear that before we started talking about the scriptures from Fresh Expressions. If you would pray with me. Lord, I ask you to be with us all. I ask you to be here in your spirit. Be with the words that are about to be read. Be with the meaning behind them. Let us all have open hearts and open minds as we hear the scripture and the music. And I ask you to be with me and let my words be pleasing to you. Amen. So I want to show a short video, and I wanted to give you a little bit of background to it. This is Ryan Leaf. He was a quarterback in the NFL. He was drafted number 2 in 1998, which basically means overall he was people thought he was the second best quarterback coming out of that graduation class in college. He only played 4 years, and in 2012, he was arrested on drug charges, and he spent 5 years in prison. So the video I'm going to show you is about only a minute and a half, but he's talking to the Kansas State football team. And what he said kind of reminded me of what we're going to talk about today, so I'm going to play it for you. And it's raining. Cross your fingers, we have a good Wi-Fi signal.
Because of what you've done, nobody else. Coaches. plane in up, not start. Being screwed, being picked up. You do your part. You control what you control. Period. I hate it when people show me the mirror. I hate it because guess what? Those are not the best qualities of you. And who cares about you most unconditionally? Probably your family and his coaching staff, right? I mean, they show you the mirror every single day on film, in practice. They want you to be successful more than anybody. Like, I don't want anybody to go on and have an incredible high school college career, be drafted very high in the draft, and then just crash and burn so my name gets thrown off the page with biggest butts. Right? I don't want that. I don't want anybody to ever be as miserable as I once was. I want you all to be so successful. And it doesn't have to be football. But in life, and being able to come to a university like this and be a part of it, that is warranted. That's given to you. Know that. Accountability.
As I was reading the first chapter of this book, and I think the other chapters are going to probably be a lot like it. They're going to kind of ask you, what are you doing? Is it working? What have you done? And that's the reason why this stood out for me, because the mirror that we're talking about, I think we're going to look at a lot in the mirror as we talk through this book. A couple stories I'm going to share with you. First, probably my fifth time preaching at a church, I had somebody from conference come in and visit, and they pulled me into the library and they said, "You're doing a good job, but I don't feel like, or I've been told that it doesn't feel like you're genuine." And I said, "Well, I'm not. I'm not because I'm not doing it my way. See, my way is not to read from paper. My way is to talk from the heart. And because of the fact that I didn't know this church, I was reading. So I knew my heart wasn't in what I was preaching." So that's what I knew. He showed me the mirror, and I decided I have to make a change. I have to change what I'm doing. Now, have any of you experienced the pleasure? I don't know if they still do it these days. Of a work evaluation. Yeah. Fun stuff, isn't it? Because I remember, I started working when I was 16, and the first time I had experience, I was probably 18 or 19, and as the manager's pointing out all this stuff that I can improve on, I'm getting defensive. I'm like, man, I come in, I do my job, I work, what else do you want? I remember one of my managers told me, it's not about what you're doing, it's about what I think you can do better. It didn't matter to me younger, when I was younger, because I just had that wall up. But that, looking back, was the perfect way of trying to make me a better employee. Was I'm evaluating you as you are now, because I think you can do a lot better than what you're doing. And then you have those famous talks with your parents. When your parents call you on something and you realize that they're right and I am not going to admit it. Funny story. Hope Jen doesn't mind me sharing it. So I met Jen and we started dating, obviously. And one night we watched a movie. I fell asleep. When I woke up, it was 3 a.m. Now, I knew my mom wasn't going to be happy. I'm hoping that I can get home and get in bed before she knows I was out that late. And, I mean, we're talking, I was 26, 27. just to show you what kind of a fear I had in my mind. So I get home, I open up the back door, and she is sitting at the table, and I knew I was in trouble. But her point was, I understand that you like this girl, but you work tomorrow. And another thing too is you didn't call to tell me you were going to be out till 3 in the morning or what was going on. So I remember thinking to myself again, you get that defensive wall of, well, yeah, whatever. But looking back, she was just trying to make the situation better, the communication better. And she was trying to remind me that my job was going to suffer if I was out till 3 in the morning every night. So she showed me in the mirror. So today's scripture that's in Fresh Expressions is Revelations 2 and 3. A lot of scripture there. So what we're going to do is we're going to kind of skim over it. But I encourage you, if you're in the book study, make sure you read everything. And you might have a different opinion than what I have. You might have something speak to you differently, and that's fine. Or if you're not in the book study, the scriptures are up on Facebook, so you can look them up and read them as you want to. But basically, this is from John. This is John writing to different areas, different churches, and it's Revelation is about John's visionary experience with the resurrected Jesus. So a couple of things that stuck out to me in chapter 2, this is to a message to Ephesus. I know your works, your labor, and your endurance. I also know that you don't put up with those who are evil. See, all these letters to these different people, it's almost like a review. I see what you're doing is good. But I also see this, that you need to work on. And then later in the scriptures, it says, you have shown endurance and put up with a lot for my name's sake. And you haven't gotten tired. But I have this against you. You have let go of the love you had at first. Change your hearts and lives and do the things you did at first. And can you imagine being a church? This is the one that really stuck out to me. Can you imagine being a church and reading this? You're doing a great job. Your works, your labor. But you know what? The love that you have towards God and to Christ just isn't the same. It's just not the same as it was before. And I think a lot of us get that way. A lot of us get pounded to the ground by life, and our love for Christ and the hope kind of gets smaller. And that is a mirror being shown to that group. And then there's a message to Smyrna. Don't be afraid of what you are going to suffer. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. So he's reassuring them that keep doing what you're doing. It's going to be a long road, but keep doing what you're doing. Pergamum? I really miss Dorothy, by the way. She was my word person. But anyhow, trip up the Israelites so that they would eat food, sacrifice to idols, and commit sexual immorality. So change your hearts and lives. If you don't, I'm coming to you soon, and I will make war on them with the sword that comes against what they're doing. Thyatira, I know your works, your love, and faithfulness, your service and endurance. I also know that the works you have done most recently are even greater than those you did at first. And then he talks about Jezebel. You allow her to teach and to mislead servants into committing sexual immorality and eating food sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to change her heart and life, but she refuses to change her life of prostitution. So they're allowing her to preach things that are false. And then, on top of that, he asked her to change her life, and she decided not to. So it made me think about what we're doing, what we can do differently. And for me, things are different. You all know this. This is my opinion only. But the days of us looking for members to fill up pews and offering plates, fill committee spots, those days are gone. They're needed. But that philosophy is something that we need to get over. The philosophy that you hear now is about making a connection, about being able to show Christ's love, and having that have an impact on somebody's life. It doesn't matter, let me rephrase that. They can either come here and grow as a disciple, or they can go to another church. But more importantly, if they're growing. I told all my youth, and I pray for them all the time, I don't care if you come here, go somewhere. Because that's what it's all about. Is if they can find the connection to go to another church and learn more about God, that's what we're shooting for. The origin of the name Fresh Expressions comes from part of the book of the Common Prayer, which states that the church is called to proclaim its faith afresh in each generation. What does it mean to proclaim our faith afresh? That's one of the questions in the book. What does it mean to proclaim our faith afresh? I read one of the comments on this book, and it said, another book that's going to fix the church. But you'll hear at the end that that's not the philosophy so far that I've read in this book. This book tries to help you think, we're doing these good things, but can we do more? Or maybe we're not doing these things right, and we need to think about doing this better. But most importantly, it's about that connection that we try to share with people. And that is a sad, that is an ironic statement for me to make as a pastor, because if we go out and we make connections and then everybody finds Christ and they love others like we're supposed to, but not one of them sets foot in the sanctuary, I feel like that's a victory. But on the flip side, what does that do for us? We always get back to that. What does that do for Griffin First? It's a tough situation. It's a tough way of thinking. But in the scripture, you'll find that a lot of the letters that he wrote ends like this. This is in chapter 2, verse 11. If you can hear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Again, chapter 2, 29. If you can hear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Chapter 3, 6. If you can hear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Chapter 3, 13. If you can hear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Chapter 3, 22. If you can hear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. The key here is as we're looking and we're examining, we're reading this book and we're looking at the scriptures and we're looking at us in the mirror. We have to do that with the Spirit. We have to do that with the Holy Spirit right next to us, ready for the journey that we're about to take. So, I want to close with the book's closing thought in the first chapter. This Bible study in our congregation is not a task or committee, but rather a group of people studying together fresh expressions and scripture. As you meet today, encourage your group not to go home and work out ways to fix the church. Rather, invite them into prayer and more study before you walk towards solutions. So if we have the idea that we're going to read this book and we're going to read this scripture and we're going to get ideas right away, that's not what it's about. What it's about is for us to be in prayer to see where the Spirit is taking us. If you can hear what the Spirit says, is what it's telling us. We can have all the plans in the world, but if our focus isn't with the Holy Spirit working with us to move forward, we're not going to get anywhere. We might get somewhere, but we might not get where we need to be. So I encourage you, as we talk about these scriptures and you're in the book study, don't think about a miracle idea that's going to fix the church. Be in prayer about how we can move together as a group. And that's most importantly, too, is if one person has this idea and we have 20 different ideas, we're not going to get anywhere. Communication is key. So working together is key. We have to be in this together with the Spirit in order to make our church be what it's supposed to be. So, maybe what we ought to do is when we're getting ready in the morning and you look in the mirror, maybe just say a prayer. Just say a prayer. Lord, I don't know where you want me to go. Lord, I don't know where your Griffith first is going. But be here with us as we look at